make. Hurry, Mr. Bergeron's on. Don't forget the popcorn, Frank.
Coming, dear.
Hi, and welcome to the next episode of Bergeron Briefs, a series of programs that I've been doing for a couple years now here in Ashland. My name is Art Bergeron. I work at Myrick O'Connell. As you know, the goal of these presentations, as opposed to the seminars that I often do at the Council on Aging at the Senior Center, is to really give you a real clear picture of a particular issue by talking to a real specialist and getting that issue more in depth. And with me here is a real specialist, Alan Falk. Alan is an attorney with us at Myrick O'Connell and has been here for a while and is going to talk about taxes. And since this is the end of the year, he's going to talk to you about taxes, especially as they relate to things you may be thinking about doing at the end of the year. Alan, thank you very much for coming.
Thank you for inviting me, Arthur.
So before we get into the details about taxes, which I know you love talking about this stuff, can you just tell us a little bit about you? Like,
sure.
Who are you, and why are you at Myrick O'Connell, and why are you doing taxes?
It's an interesting story. I went to college, and I said the one thing I don't want to do in college is go into accounting. Well, I ended up liking accounting, and even more, I liked doing tax. I like the challenge. I think it's a big puzzle, putting pieces together.
Definitely stimulating.
It is, and it's always changing. I spent a lot of time learning the new rules. And
the new rules are always new. They are forever changing.
They're forever changing. Right. And I think there are certain areas of the law that don't change as much. Actually, most areas of the law, I suggest, don't change as much. With tax, every year, it seems, there are new tax provisions that are coming out. And further on in our discussion, we'll talk about some of the changes that may be happening within the next month or two.
Oh, there's more, literally more on the way like right now?
Well, there are what called extensions. There are certain provisions in the tax code that will expire. They'll sunset in sometimes 2, sometimes 3 years.
Yeah.
And there are a couple that the individuals get to take advantage of that have expired. They expired for tax years after 2013, so we currently don't have these provisions.
Well, so let's go right into that. Let's go right into that. And as I was mentioning to you, one of the reasons I wanted you on now is that it's mid-November, and there are some issues that I know, even as a kind of just random lawyer who knows a little about tax, but not a lot, that there are certain pieces of your planning that you want to be doing at the end of the year, literally because the year is ending.
That's right.
And I know at the end, after you talk about other issues, I'd like to talk a little bit about gifting, because I know that's a real piece of this, and I want to be encouraging people to give in the right way. But tell me, so if you're my good friends Frank and Mary, and you have some assets, and you have some cash and income, you got a house, but you've got some investments worth several $100,000, and you've got income coming in from them, so what do you think about? What do you think about at the end of the year that you really need to be paying attention to?
Okay. Well, keeping in mind that from a tax perspective, most things are hard closed December 31st. They're either done or they're not.
Yeah.
One of them is if you're employed and you're putting into a 401k plan, have you maxed out your 401k plan?
Have you put as much in as you could?
That's right. So for example, for 2014, we're looking at an individual can put up to $17,500 a year. So they should be looking at their, their last pay stub and saying, am I going to hit that target? And if not, can I afford to put in more?
And can you continue to contribute that way no matter how old you are, as long as you're still working?
Excellent question. If you are over 50, there's what's called the catch-up. So you can put even more than the $17,500, and you can put an additional $5,500 in.
You can put as much as
$23,000
a year in there, and that makes it non-taxable in this year.
That's
because,
right.
Because you're putting it in.
Exactly.
I
so you get it off the top, if you will. You're not paying tax on it in the current year.
Yeah.
And you get the tax-deferred growth. Because if it's in your 401k plan, it's not being taxed on an annual basis.
While it's in there. So even the income that it's earning while it's in there isn't being taxed.
Exactly.
In addition to the fact that when you put the money in, it's not being taxed. So it's kind of a double whammy.
Well, it is. And the hope is that that tax deferral will be significant and you can start taking it out.
Yeah.
You can take it out at any point in time. If you take it out before you're 59 and a half, you get hit with a 10% penalty.
Mm-hmm.
If you take it out after that, it's subject to ordinary income tax. You do have to start taking minimum distributions when you turn 70 and a half. So that's one thing to consider. Have you maxed out your 401k plan?
I'm going to be 65 next year. And so I'm actually in this little category where I can be playing catch up and really trying to grow these funds for when I retire, if I ever get a chance to retire.
That's right.
A great point.
Okay. So that's one thing to consider. Yeah. Another one is charitable contributions. That's a big thing at the end of the year. People tend to think about making their annual gifts to various charities.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things I suggest considering, you can gift donated property, appreciated property. So for example, you bought, we'll say IBM stock, and you've held it for more than a year, and you paid $100 for it, and now it's worth $200. If you gift it to a charity, you can take a deduction of $200.
You can take the whole deduction.
The whole deduction, even though
But isn't there some kind of tax that you have to pay when you sell?
There is. Well, because you're not selling it, you're transferring it in kind to the charity.
I see.
The charity gets it, and from most charities, they want cash. They don't want IBM stock, so they're going to sell it, and they're not going to pay an income tax. And you have avoided $100 in my example of capital gains.
I see.
Now,
that's a really interesting. As a matter of fact, I just had a client came in. If I recall correctly, the stock is Raytheon stock, but they've had it forever. They were in the company, and they bought it really low. So they bought it, I want to say, at 20, and it's worth $300, $400. So that could be a tremendous benefit to them in terms of if they want to take the charitable. It's a good way to make a charitable contribution and still save some money.
That's right, because they're not reporting the gain. And they're getting a deduction equal to the full amount.
By the way, I was supposed to tell myself as well as everybody else to shut off their phones before we started. Sorry about that. So that's a great device, and it's not. And if you were planning on making a charitable contribution anyway, you're actually cutting the taxes that you're going to be paying this year.
That's right. And from a charity's perspective, whether it's $300 in stock or $300 in cash is pretty much the same.
I see. Now, what about if is there anything, a lot of times even at the end of the year, people are thinking about giving things to their children.
Okay.
Can we talk about that for a few minutes?
Absolutely.
So if I regularly am told by my clients that they're thinking about giving things, money to their children, sometimes because it's around Christmas, it's the end of the year, so they're kind of looking at their books.
Mm-hmm.
They'll say, but I know I can't give them more than $14,000. Or I can't give them any, actually some of my older clients will say they know they can't give them more than $10,000,
right,
and they're sure of it. So can we just talk about the gift tax system and what those numbers come from and how it works?
Sure. The $14,000 that they're thinking of, or the $10,000, or what it used to be, is called the annual exclusion. And what the annual exclusion is that each individual can gift to another person up to $14,000 without using up any of their exemption amount.
And that is to any person at all.
To any person at all.
And without using up their exemption amount. And if they give away that $14,000, are they taxed on that gift?
They are not.
And the person who receives that gift, is that person who receives the gift taxed on the receipt of the gift?
They are not. So it is tax free, if you will, as long as it's $14,000 or less. If it's over $14,000, we start to use some of our exemption.
And what does that mean?
The exemption is the amount that you can transfer without actually paying any tax out of pocket.
Mm-hmm.
For 2014, it is a number north of $5 million. It's approximately $5.34 million. So that means each individual...
So today, I could, if I wanted to, give away $5.34 million without paying any tax.
That's right. Now, if you gave over anything above that away next year, you'd be paying a tax. Although that number's indexed for inflation, so depending on how much you gave away, it keeps going up.
It keeps going.
Yep, that was one of the provisions that passed, I believe, 2 years ago. To have this exemption amount indexed for inflation.
So if I've given away, say this year I decide that I'm going to give my child $20,000.
Mm-hmm.
So that's over your magic $14,000 amount by $6,000.
Yes.
So what?
But are you married?
Yes, and I'm married.
Okay, so now your wife can also give $14,000 a year. So between you and your wife, you have an exemption amount of $28,000 per person. So your $20,000 is still not going to be a taxable gift.
Let's take that same example. We're giving to the same child. And let's say now that I'm giving them, instead of giving them $28,000, I'm giving them $40,000.
Okay, $40,000.
This year, I've got $40,000 just giving to one child.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that my exemption you just told me, which means something, is $28,000. So because I gave them $40,000, what does that mean?
Okay. What that means is you're filing a gift tax return now.
I have to file a gift
tax return. You have to file a gift tax return. And what's going to happen is you're going to report a taxable gift of $40,000. You have an exclusion, an annual exclusion between you and your wife mm-hmm. of $28,000,
mm-hmm.
two times the $14,000.
Yep.
So you now have a net gift of $12,000. Yep. That means the $5.34 million that we just talked about
yep.
is going to be reduced by $12,000.
So it doesn't mean I'm not paying a tax.
You're not going to write a check for that.
I'm not paying a tax on any amount.
That's right.
On any of that.
Yes.
But it's reducing this other amount.
Correct.
And what's the significance of that reduction?
So what happens, there's a unified system between the estate and the gift tax. Mm-hmm. So you've got this $5.34 million each person of an exemption amount. What happens as you make taxable gifts during your lifetime, that number comes down.
And taxable gifts means the amount that's above, in this case, $28,000, two times 14 because I'm married.
Exactly. So we've now reduced that number by $12,000.
Mm-hmm.
And every year you make a gift that goes over your annual exclusion, we'll continue to reduce that number. Upon your death, an estate tax return may or may not be due. An estate tax return is due, we have to look at how much of that exemption amount do you still have left.
Mm-hmm.
We've gone from $5.34 million and we've reduced it by $12,000. So if your estate is, I'm going to make up a number, $1.5 million, you're still under the 5.34, less the $12,000.
Even after the subtraction of this $12,000 and whatever else I've subtracted during my lifetime.
That's right.
I just need to be below that.
Whatever you have left. It's if you want to think of it as, well, just right. think of it as an exemption amount.
Yep.
And so now you're going to file, you may file a federal estate tax return, but you're not going to pay a tax because you have enough of the exemption.
Yep.
But you will if you're a resident of Massachusetts, and assuming you don't leave your estate to your surviving spouse, you are going to have a tax due to the state of Massachusetts.
I see. So how does this so-called exemption amount that you're talking about, how does that connect to the state system? Because you told me that the big exemption amount was a federal exemption amount.
Right. Massachusetts, it's an interesting system that they have. You have a $1 million amount.
Yeah.
That $1 million is reduced by these gifts that exceed the $14,000.
So people kind of know, and there's a kind of common knowledge, that if you're in Massachusetts, if you have an estate that's worth less than a million dollars, you don't have to pay an estate tax. But you're saying if you've made these large gifts, that is gifts more than for an individual $14,000 and for a couple $28,000 in a year, then the extra amount reduces that $1 million?
It does. Yes and no. What happens is Massachusetts has what's called a filing threshold, and mm-hmm. it's the $1 million.
Mm-hmm.
You have to look at gifts that you made during your lifetime that exceeded the $14,000.
Mm-hmm.
And you add it back to what's in your taxable estate, what you have in your hands.
Mm-hmm.
And if you get over $1 million, when we take those two numbers together, you then need to file a Massachusetts estate tax return and pay a Massachusetts estate tax. However, the estate tax would only be calculated on what is in your hands, not what you've given away in the past.
Oh, okay.
Yes, there's a misconception amongst many people that there's an exclusion or exemption amount of $1 million
right.
in Massachusetts, but it's really a filing threshold. And once you cross over that threshold, you then need to file a return and pay the tax.
And you're going to pay a tax. And the amount of that threshold keeps going down if you've made these big gifts.
Yes,
right?
Exactly.